This is the story of Airbus Industrie Flight 129. On the 30th of June 1994, Airbus was putting the Airbus A330-300 through its paces. That round of tests were to certify the autopilot of the plane to the CAT 3 standards. For that purpose, they carried out two go-arounds and approaches with the plane. Earlier in the day, the captain had carried out two go-arounds with a simulated engine failure. All of this testing took place at Toulouse Airport. Airbus has a manufacturing facility nearby. After they landed the plane, the next thing they had to test was an engine failure during a takeoff. To do this, they'd take off and then they'd shut down an engine and its corresponding hydraulic circuit to simulate an engine failure. In addition to that, the center of gravity of the plane would be at the extreme aft limit. By the way, aft means towards the tail or the stern. So in this context, it meant that the center of gravity would be further back than usual. This test would be the worst of the worst case scenarios. That's usually how aircraft testing is done. There's this video on Boeing's YouTube channel where they're testing a 747-8. They're testing the plane to see how the plane would handle a rejected takeoff. And for the test, the plane was at its max takeoff weight and they were using worn out brake pads. Really, a worst of the worst situation. Which makes sense. If the plane can survive that, it can handle anything that the real world can throw at it. So, once in the air, they would see how the plane would handle with a failed engine. The pilots needed to see how the plane would behave during the takeoff. How would it nose up? What would it be like to fly? How would the speed be affected during the takeoff? After getting all of that data, the pilots would make an engine out approach and land the plane. With that, the plane lined up with runway 33 and the crew prepared for the engine out test. The trim was set and the crew did the math for the flight. For the first takeoff, the captain was the one to pilot the plane. This time, the first officer would be the one at the controls. The captain would shut the left-hand engine down to simulate an engine failure. With that, the plane took off. Their initial attempts to engage the autopilot was unsuccessful. The first officer was exerting a tiny amount of force on the side stick, and so it did not engage. As all of this was happening, the plane climbed and it gained speed. Soon, the plane's nose had fallen from 29 degrees to 25 degrees. With the plane in the predetermined configuration, the captain pulled back power on the left-hand engine and shut off its hydraulic lines to simulate an engine failure. But as they did that, the plane pitched up. The nose rose from about 25 degrees to 32 degrees, and as it did that, the plane bled off its airspeed, all the way down to 100 knots. This was well below the 118 knots needed for flight. The plane started to roll to the left due to the thrust asymmetry, and so the captain immediately pulled the right engine back as well to keep his plane under control. The nose of the plane began to drop, and the pilots were getting control of their plane back. But, unfortunately, they did not have the time or altitude to recover. The plane crashed. None of the seven people on board survived. With the test plane in pieces, it was up to the investigative board to figure out what had gone wrong. As always, they looked at the state of the plane to see if the plane was mechanically sound before flight. Nothing looked off. As far as they could tell, the plane was all right. It was fit to fly. But they found slight issues in the pre-flight preparations. They didn't have a formal pre-flight briefing before the flight, but the investigators were certain that the pilots knew what they had to do. For most of the flight crew performed brilliantly. The first takeoff by the captain went off without a hitch, even though the center of gravity was near the aft limit. This may have made them confident in the abilities of the plane. Feeling confident from the first flight, they got ready for the next one. But this time they'd be taking off at max power and not a reduced power setting like before. They'd have to be extra careful about rotation because the plane could nose up quite quickly if they weren't careful. The pilots set the trim. This was their first mistake. They set the trim to 2.2 degrees of nose up. This wasn't out of limits or anything. But remember, their center of gravity is further back than usual, and for that configuration, this trim setting was not right. This would mess with the plane's pitch a bit. During the takeoff, the co-pilot was pushing the nose down to manage the nose-up tendency of the plane, and this masked the incorrect trim settings. The investigators noticed something unusual as things started to go wrong. The autopilot mode changed. the autopilot was initially in the SRS or speed reference system mode. So what does the SRS mode do? It manages the plane's speed during takeoff. The SRS mode keeps the plane's speed above a certain threshold and adds a safety buffer on top of that. During the accident sequence, as flight 129 climbed, the pilot shut the left-hand engine down, and after this, the autopilot switched modes. It went into the altitude acquisition mode. In the altitude acquisition mode, the autopilot would, as the name suggests, get to a predefined altitude. The autopilot switched modes because the predefined conditions for a switch were satisfied. The autopilot had a target altitude given to it, in this case, 2,000 feet, and the vertical speed was right in line. So, the conditions were satisfied, and the autopilot switched modes. As all of this was happening, the captain was busy shutting the engines down and the hydraulic lines, so he was out of the loop. The autopilot was now doing everything in its power to get the plane to 2,000 feet. The autopilot pitched the nose of the plane up. The plane was now at 28 degrees of pitch, and the captain realized that something was wrong. The plane could not keep up with this on one engine. By the time the autopilot was disconnected, the plane was at 32 degrees of pitch and at 100 knots, very close to a stall. Their full power takeoff now came back to haunt them. Due to one engine being at max power, there was a significant thrust asymmetry acting on the plane, and that's what caused the roll to the left. Once the captain realized what was happening, he acted quickly. He pulled back power on the other engine to prevent the roll from getting any worse. He also brought the nose down, but it was too late. They just did not have the altitude to recover. Looking at the chain of events, the autopilot switching modes was the start of their troubles. Why did that happen? One of the reasons for the switch was the presence of a selected altitude. 2,000 feet was selected as the target altitude, but the takeoff plan did not call for that. Why was 2,000 feet selected on the autopilot? Their previous landing required them to descend from 10,000 feet to 2,000 feet. For this, they would have set their target altitude to 2,000 feet. Apparently, they never changed that. So when they took off again, the autopilot's target altitude was set to 2,000 feet. So once the plane was airborne, the autopilot wanted to get the plane to 2,000 feet, which caused the plane to pitch up too much because it just did not have the power to do that. Why did the crew make such a mistake? Well, for one, they had too much confidence in their plane. The plane flew perfectly the first time around. On top of that, the captain had a very, very busy day. An article on the crash called it a, quote, punishingly busy day, end quote. On that day, the captain had to fly an A321 demo flight, supervise a simulator session, and attend two meetings, one of which was a press briefing. It is possible that he was just very, very tired by the time he set foot in the cockpit of the A330. This may explain a 3-second delay in the captain taking control of the plane. He may have just been fatigued. Another explanation is that the crew duties were not clearly defined. They all knew what the test was meant to accomplish, but there wasn't a whole lot of clarity on who did what. For example, even the test engineer took some time to react to the flight parameters. For this crash, a lot of small things had to go wrong. The center of gravity was at its aft limit. The wrong trim setting increased the plane's propensity to pitch up. The preselected altitude of 2,000 feet caused the autopilot to switch into an undesirable mode. The captain was tired and took too long to respond to the crisis. It was the perfect storm. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.